Good morning, everyone. I have the great pleasure to introduce today's plenary speaker. My name is Christoph Schulz, and I'm with the University of Duisburg-Essen in Germany. So today's plenary speaker, Sotiris Pratsinis, is professor of process engineering, adjunct professor of material science, and director of the Particle Technology Lab at the ETH Zurich in Switzerland. His research focuses on aerosol processing of materials with applications in catalysis, ceramics, sensors, batteries, bio and nutritional materials. Sotiris' work includes studies of the kinetics of particle formation and particle interaction. The results for many material systems have become standard for industrial applications in the meantime. On the other hand, Sotiris has pioneered flame-based synthesis of functional nanomaterials. The spray flame process that he calls flame spray pyrolysis is very widespread in many labs as well as in industry. Sotiris' highly creative work has always been inspired by applications. It has led to more than 300 refereed journal articles, 20 patents that are licensed to various industries, and he has contributed to the creation of 4 spin-off companies. Originally from Greece, Sotiris received his PhD in 1985 from the University of California, Los Angeles. Before he moved to Switzerland in 1998, he was professor at the University of Cincinnati for 13 years. His research has been recognized by numerous awards and fellowships and supported by an ERC advanced grant. Out of these awards, I just want to mention the Alexander von Humboldt Research Award, which fortunately brought him to our lab for several months a few years ago. So, Sotiris, we are looking forward to your talk entitled Flame Synthesis of Functional Nanostructured Materials and Devices, Surface Growth and Aggregation.
Thank you, sir. Good morning. Thank you all for coming early morning to the meeting. It's not trivial to be here. And I would like to thank Christoph for his fabulous introduction and the organizers for giving me the opportunity to share with you some of the activities of our laboratories. And in particular, what I would like really to leave you today with a message that some soot is good, is really good. For example, the picture that you see here, these carbon-coated metallic particles are sold for 100,000 to 1 million per kilogram. Please keep in mind, gold sells for 42,000 per kilogram. So in this presentation, I will also at the end show you, actually, some new devices are created where the key component of the device is flame-made materials. And that's how actually a new application is developed. But being in this part of the world and in the Far East more broadly, I want to show you the picture that especially inspired my career. This is actually a picture of a brave Chinese worker, as you can see here, without any protection to the face. That what he does here is actually scrapes from the wall the products of pyrolysis, of vegetable oil pyrolysis, which is nothing else but our familiar soot. We'll put them on this vial, and then these particles actually, they will make the famous Chinese inks, you know, and all this Chinese artwork that you have seen over the years. And this is actually a lamp black, and that particular paper, I always recommend my new students to, when they start their classes in my laboratory, to read this one because it's an inspiring 3 or 4 page article about the opportunities of combustion in material synthesis. And having said this, I would like now to point out that this technology has prevailed for centuries in the world. In fact, this is a picture of the Bible of Gutenberg, and this has been actually made by ink that was produced exactly the same way for hundreds of years in Europe without any, let's say, technology transfer. Is actually the people, they used to work like that for years to create the inks and the even Romans to smoke sausages and so on. This has been the classic technology. Until, of course, today, We make carbon black in for tires, as you can see here. And this is the key application. And if you ever had to fix a tire, a flat tire, and you lift it, you should know that 30% by weight of the tire is flame-made particles, carbon particles, nanostructured particles. And this today is a business of $10 billion. And the key actually process is the so-called furnace process, which is nothing else but fuel-rich combustion, where about half of the oil here is pyrolyzed to create the soot. And as you can see here, you can actually, this is a very challenging process because you have to extinguish to lower the temperature fairly quickly with water. And essentially, the products are soot particles and hydrogen. And actually, the issues to process these materials is quite a challenging one. At the same time, another major product, a commodity, is what I call the whitest of the whites, the snow white of materials, which is nothing else, rutile titanium dioxide. And this is actually used for paints. This is an application in the order of about $5 billion today. And the dominant technology is actually combustion. Another major product is fumed. Actually, what I need to point out here, the production rates are quite high. On a single line, you can find out here is 25 tons per hour, and the Reynolds number in the order of 1 million. And the third major combustion product is fumed silica, originally developed as a substitute for carbon black. But now it is a material that you can find it everywhere, primarily as a flowing aid, but you can find it in cosmetics, as you can see in the picture, in pharmaceuticals, and eventually is actually one of these materials with a wonder material out there. Nevertheless, what I would like to point out here to everybody, this technology, which is actually a major industry today, has been developed by Valiant engineering, by Valiant, let's say, trial and error effort, and rather limited systematic combustion or aerosol science. And what is an example of that? For example, DuPont makes TiO2, rutile TiO2. What is the magic size? At about 200 nanometers. Photocatalysts, which are actually particles which are mostly the anatase phase, they will be made by the same process that you make silica here. So a lot of this knowledge has been developed over a very narrow set of process conditions. So there is a lot in this field actually to be understood. In fact, another company, a major manufacturer for pigments, they make rutile titania by flame technology, and they make catalytic titania by wet technology. It's actually very interesting, the know-how that has been developed around this field in industry. So there is a lot to be better understood, as you will see here in a few slides, where actually, by systematic understanding, you can control the particle size, at least over an order of magnitude, if you follow the basics of this field. The next big success story of combustion is the manufacture of optical fibers. People would draw glass for centuries, and they will make, if you have been to Italy, to Murano, beautiful artwork. However, this glass cannot be used for transmission or of electromagnetic signals. To do that, you had to make high purity, and this purity actually can only be met by combustion. And you can see here the three processes, the VAD or the OVD, the outside vapor deposition, the vapor axial deposition, and the modified chemical vapor deposition, pioneered by different industries that actually rely on this schematic of this combustion, by the combustion of silicon tetrachloride primarily. And what is interesting to point out, because this field was developed in the mid-80s, in particular, the MCVD was developed by combining fluid and particle dynamics, because this particular process actually is done in laminar flow, where actually the particle and the fluid mechanics can be easily combined. Now, why people like combustion? The key property of combustion is the scalability. The number one reason, because today, if you read science, nature, you see beautiful particles, beautiful films. However, very few of those can be scaled up. The previous applications that you have seen is actually a clear sign that combustion can scale up the synthesis of materials. Second, it does not involve liquid byproducts. Third, it's easier particle collection because it's much easier to separate particles from a gas than particles from a liquid. Already I talked about high purity products. A major advantage here that creates a lot of excitement is that you can capture metastable phases in a stable fashion. Sixth, you can make particles of unique morphology, as we'll discuss in depth today, this filamentary structure. It's an efficient, few, and fast unit operations. And from the modelers for theoretician, it affords process design from first principles. It is what we teach to our students, that the diffusivity in gases is better understood than the diffusivity in liquids. You rely on the Chapman-Escoq equation in diffusivity, while in the liquids you have to rely on the Stokes-Einstein with the steric effects. It's far more challenging, and this early on builds up uncertainty in the design. So, however, at the same time, there are disadvantages, as we just published an article in the Chemical Society Reviews, where it's not so easy for everybody to pick up this technology. Why it requires some capital investment? Hoods, controls, filters. Safety, it's an important issue here that all of us working in this field, we very well understand. But outside, it's not so straightforward. People to take the precautions that required, and you will see later on. Precursor availability, preparation and handling is also an important issue that is not always easily appreciated. And product purity, morphology, uniformity, and composition, the so-called PICs, product of incomplete combustion, or crystallinity, because of the short residence times involved, is not so easy actually to always make crystalline particles. So these are issues that you have to reckon with. Having said all of this, what is the state of the art today in the field, how we understand it? Typically, you see here this combustor, this is the flame. What I really want you to keep in mind during my lecture today is that collisions dominate the process, collisions between molecules, between clusters, and particles. Essentially, coagulation is the underlying theme of the process. This is a continuous concept here that you have to keep in mind. And otherwise, we have what you know very well, the first step, the inception, where actually particles are formed. It was a beautiful lecture yesterday by Dr. Hope Mikkelsen. I didn't know her, but I really appreciated her presentation. It's followed by surface growth, and by sintering, and at the same time, sintering or coalescence. And this is what we call in the field the area where actually we form aggregation, which is different than what she defined yesterday. It's exactly the opposite term we're using here. But for me, the best way to somehow emphasize this is that, this is chemical bonding that we have between the particles, what you have this well somehow bonded particles, and this is what we'll call, while the other particles here, the collisions that they will form, this will be the so-called the agglomeration, where there is primarily a physical bonding between the particles. This is very important. In classic soot formation, that distinction is not so critical, but in our business is essential. Why? Because, let me be more exact here, if you want to make particles, let's say for optical fibers or for catalysts, these are the ideal structures. Why? Because at the end, you would like to form a packed bed. So gases flowing into the packed bed and out, they are facilitated by these open acicular structures. Or if you want to make devices, as we'll discuss later on, these particles actually behave like carbon nanotubes. They facilitate electron transfer. On the other hand, if you like to make paints or nanocomposites, agglomerates is the attractive form that they should have. So being able to make either aggregates or agglomerates at will is the essence in this technology. So I say to my students, if you make aggregates, there is opportunities, there are options. If you make agglomerates, that's also great. If you don't make particles, there are even, you know, people, there is a whole technology that really, especially the CVD, that films that they do not want particles at any cost. So it's actually flame synthesis of materials is a field where you win on the red, you win on the black, you can even win on the green, on the zero, okay? The only thing is you need to know what you are doing. So having said this, we have to understand now that in this material synthesis, this is what would differentiate this from the classic field of soot formation in combustion, which is a mainstream in this conference, is actually the essence and actually the morphology of the particles. I will focus a lot about that particular aspect. So having said this now, I was asked when I submitted this paper for the conference, what are the key concepts in the field? The key idea is what I call the high temperature particle residence time. During the combustion, there is a magic window, and the easiest way to think of it is like in baseball, the strike zone. In that particular zone, where actually you can interfere, you can actually make a lot of impact on the particle formation, but earlier than that or after that, really, it's very little you can do. So you have to recognize, and this actually can be different. If you want to make particles, agglomerates, or aggregates, or crystalline, there are different, actually, the high temperature particle residence time is quite different. For example, in manufacture of titania, the pigments, the reactor is 100 meters long. Why? Because you want to assure the development of the rutile phase. In case of fumed silica, it's only about 5 meters from the flame until you collect the particles. The second concept is the self-preserving particle size distribution. What did we say? Particles collide. The fact that you collide, you have these high concentrations, very quickly reach an asymptotic shape in the distribution, which is called self-preserving, and this is actually well known. The geometric standard deviation is 1.45 for perfect spheres. And what is the idea? That actually particles, as you can see here, the concentration as a function of diameter, continuously grow, as you would expect, during coagulation. However, if you scale them with the average particle size, in these conditions, all the data collapse onto a single line. This is a contribution from Sheldon Freelander that was developed in the context of air pollution, but never really developed traction in that field. Why? Particle concentrations in the atmosphere are not that high as during carbon black formation, for example, or fumed silica and so on. But in this field, it's dominant. And this, of course, simplifies the process quite a lot. You can do a lot back of the envelope calculation, neglecting the spread of the distribution, and you won't be far off. The second concept here, and this is a slide I took from Dr. Mikkelsen yesterday, is the particles actually, they are in this filamentary structure, what we call fractal-like, and typically they obey this law, a power law between the mass and the radius of the particle. But the radius is a tricky concept. Let me take now a cartoon of this particle and calculate for you the different radii. You can see now with the red, the so-called radius of gyration. You can see with the blue, the mobility radius. With the black, another mobility radius. Like if you measure the mobility of a fractal particle in the continuum, in room temperature, is different than that at the high temperature. So when you do simulations for high temperature and you test with actually data that you have collected at room temperature, this, although you can have the same, this can be quite different. And of course, the most important for a practical application is this one, the green little radius, which is the equivalent mass. And now this can be important for the soot community because a lot of colleagues, they measure mobility distributions and then they want to regulate emissions by using the mobility radius as actually mass radius. And this actually can be a significant error if the soot is dry, if the soot has not collapsed, and actually is in the filamentary structure that you just saw before. This now brings me to the different structure measures for these particles. We have the so-called mass mobility exponent where the magic value is 2.15, but the fractal values, actually, this is quite solid in both free molecular and continuum regime, but the so-called mass fractal dimension can be different in the continuum in the free molecule, as you can see here. And of course, this, if we go back to the self-preserving distribution, gives a different polydispersities in terms of the agglomerate size distribution. And you have to keep this in mind. However, even for fractals, if you go to calculate the mass, for the mass, both of them are 1.3, regardless if they are spheres or agglomerates. It's a beauty, actually, how you go to these different limiting cases to be able to decipher what actually are the particle dynamics behind these fabulous structures that you see. Having said all of that, now we can go to the next step and go, because I think with all of these concepts you can get dizzy, and I will go back to what you have learned in the high school. For me, this is the experiment that I remember, the so-called, my chemistry teacher played with a Bunsen burner, and what he did, actually, and most of you know better than me, that if you play with a flow rate of the oxidant, the flame from yellow will become bluish and very short. What I was not told at the time, especially if I spike this flame with a silicon precursor to produce, in this case, as you can see here, about 17 grams per hour of silica, you can see that actually the particles are quite different. This long, slender flame will produce these big, nice, round particles and extremely tiny ones. This, a little bit different, quite spherical particles here, but later on, you see that these particles become agglomerate, let's say bonded, hard bonded, as we discussed before. And for those, I had the luxury to collaborate with Professor Craig Bocaz here to do some small angle X-ray spectroscopy. And what he told me is that these particles here, despite their fractal looking appearance, they are non-fractal, actually. However, the last ones, it is the 1.6, 1.9 on this well-defined structure that you have for filamentary particles. So you see here, by just turning the knob of the flame, you can go from the non-agglomerated particles to heavily aggregated ones. And this should also, if we actually try them for an application, as I can show you here, in this case, we use these particles in ETH for making some dental composites. You can see, despite this appearance of agglomerate structures, when you put them on a methyl methacrylate matrix, all of this is no longer there. So this is what I say, the agglomerates are not a major problem because it's reversible. You can actually, by mixing them, but the aggregates, this hard bond, it's very hard to break them apart. Now, another example is the so-called mixing. A very important, a very powerful concept in flame synthesis of materials, as you very well know in this field, is actually how you mix. And personally, I am a chemical engineer in the United States. We are called glorified plumbers. And I will do for you in the next 2 minutes the plumbing experiment or a plumbing exercise. What I have here, I have a diffusion flame burner in which I will have the precursor, titanium tetrachloride, the same one that you use to make this perfect white material. And we will provide methane on the outside ring. This is a three ring or three tubes, one inside the other. The methane on the outside, the air on the center or in the center port over here. And on the other here, we will go the reverse. We'll flip-flop the air with the methane. And actually, what we will have here in classic diffusion flame here, where actually the oxidant is on the outside, the fuel is on the inside, while on the other two flames, they will have the so-called inverse diffusion flames. And in this case, if you can actually calculate the temperature profiles, you will see that these flames here, they have a much shorter high temperature region compared to these flames here. And again, if we see what kind of particles you make in these flames, a very big difference. The inverse diffusion flame, and please keep in mind, the flow rates here are identical in all four configurations. What we have here, we see that actually you're making, on the average, 10 nanometer particles, anatase, ideal for photocatalysis. However, on the other side here, we make this large, almost 100 nanometers average particle size, non-agglomerate. And I should tell you, I was very biased from this field here when I wrote that paper back in the mid-90s. I didn't even dare to say that these particles are non-agglomerated. Why? Because I had been taught that soot is always an agglomerated and aggregated structure. However, when we did the small angle X-ray spectroscopy, then we discovered these particles are non-aggregates, are non-agglomerated, and actually in the subsequent papers, and one that I have on PECS, is actually we are calling them the right way. But in the beginning, you are not even sure of what you have when there is that type of bias in the field. Nevertheless, the beauty of this is actually, you can see, you can control here by the mixing, and this is the single most important slide from controlling the particle size, how you can very quickly control the size and composition by the mixing. It is a key part, and this is something that I have seen to be widely used in my interaction with industry and in other laboratories. Now, what is the overriding now description of this process? As in many other fields, clearly particle formation in flames is a so-called a multi-scale design process. Design needs to be handled. And here, what we see here, we have, first of all, the so-called continuum component, where actually is done very well in this field with LES, and I have seen yesterday beautiful work. I will not even discuss anything here. This is way ahead. But what I will really focus is the two mesoscale and molecular dynamics to see here, because today all the manufacturers of particles, titanium, silica, they utilize these continuum models quite actively, in particular for the temperature and velocity profiles. But what is interesting here is the structure development, or later on, or earlier on, the actual individual interaction of the particles as we try to bring the field more into the systematic science rather than the just fitting measurements, fitting a model through measurements. So here the emphasis will be on this mesoscale modeling, and what I want to point out here is we have been able to make a good progress in understanding of these materials by looking the so-called a two-particle interaction was here by an energy and a mass balance, essentially, when you have two particles and fuse, what do you have? You have reduction of the surface area. What this means is reduction of the energy, all right, the surface energy, and this actually has to be converted to heat. At the same time, you have to keep the mass balance, and what actually we have? We have actually these two particles to come, and I hope this film works here, and you can see, and slowly, primarily, the smaller particle is lost. This is very important, because you see here that the smaller particles typically fuse faster, and this is a key part in narrowing down the distribution of agglomerates. You have seen in many fields that typically the aggregates have a very narrow distribution of primaries, and this is actually can be traced to this effect. So if I go now to this scary-looking particles, and if I carry out the same simulations, you can see here, for example, and I want you to pay attention because I am not allowed to control this film and stop, you will see here a broad distribution of particles, and this rather open filamentary structure of 1.8. As it fuses, please take a look that this will become more linear, and at the same time, the individual particles, these little ones, they will be lost first, so the distribution of the agglomerate truly narrows. This is the beauty of it. Actually, we have been able to, with Professor Mendler here, to actually show that despite this so-called self-preserving distribution, these particles can behave like quantum dots because of that fusion during this coalescence. So I hope I alerted you, because it will be shown only once. So here you can see now this linear structure, and then actually this, of course, if you have enough time. But of course, in the flame, you don't have so much time. This is the important part. This is, you have plenty of time on the movie, but not during the synthesis of the particles. So what we have actually here, if you follow this magic 1.8, this is, you know, the fractal dimension of these particles. And during fusion, look at this, that the particles actually, they become even more open during fusion. They don't compact because it is these little arms first, and then later on, they will be reach this magic, this, you start from these particles, open structures, and then you move up this open You can see here the minimum, it's almost like a linear structure, and of course later on it will become a sphere. If, however, you are monitoring the fractal dynamics by mass mobility measurements, you will never see that. Why? Because look at this. You have the way that you define the so-called mass mobility exponent, essentially the projected area, is not so sensitive to this process. So you really, you miss that dip that you will have here. Nevertheless, this is interesting because the beauty of this is it's a monotonic function. If you like to control structure, the deformation that you get here can be directly related to the structure. While here, as you can see, you have areas where you can have the same fractal dimension and you can be in a different parts of the process. Having said this, we can go now to the actual distribution, and I want to show you quantitatively now how the evolution of the primary particle size distribution changes. And you can see here, if I have a very smaller aggregate, you can see here at a given time, you have these different colors reflecting of size. And this is for titania particles, originally in the 20 nanometers. And then when actually fusion takes place, you can see here that the little ones have been lost and actually how the particles become compact. And if I look at the distribution, you see this characteristic small tail shifting to the large. Essentially, the smaller particles catch up. It's exactly the same that you observe with condensation, this narrowing of the distribution. Okay? As the particles grow, the smaller ones grow faster while the big ones are slow. And a sintering does exactly the same. And of course, if you continue different times, eventually they grow much bigger ones, but you can see the beauty of this slender distribution, very narrow distribution, but these particles are aggregated ones now. Now, having said this, coming to this field, I say, wait, I cannot just tell them what I have been going on. I want to try this with some of the data. And I was very lucky to read the papers of Hai Wang, excellent documentation of data. So I was able to play a little bit with the data and see, can we apply this to soot formation, okay? And that's what I did here. We found his data for this benchmark premixed ethylene flame, and they are mostly in this free molecular regime. And essentially what we have here, as we said, a coagulation dominated, and if we have perfect coalescence, we'll have this shape, or if the particles, right after inception, they just agglomerate, they will form these structures that we talked already. However, if they follow surface growth, and I was correctly pointed out by this Haka mechanism that I saw how broadly is used in this community, we can actually have the evolution of this particles, and you can have this characteristic growth on top of the original soot particles. And of course, this is the inception. But then, of course, we are applying this law for the free molecular regime growth by for the aerosols. So what we have on this, these are the data from Hai Wang and the president of the institute, Katerina Kose-Hoinhaus, and you can see here, these are data that they are at a given height above the burner, and you can see the two, this is two different studies, but at identical conditions, and you can see how nicely they match. However, now, if I carry simulations and I neglect the structure of these particles, what do I get? Particles will be 50% smaller than the experiments. On the other hand, if I go and neglect the surface growth and I have these agglomerates, there are three times as big as the experiments. However, when we carry out that and account for surface growth, the data actually are quite close to, excuse me, they are quite close to the simulations. And you can see here actually almost in this area where actually you have tried to stay above the 5 nanometers where they are starting to be close to the inception particle size. And even the more challenging aspect is what happens with the mass fractal dimension, the structure of these particles, and I have plotted here the mass fractal dimension and the mean mobility diameter, and these are the pictures from the papers of Schenk et al., the one by Hai Wang and Katerina Kose-Hoinhaus, and you can see here these are data at different heights above the burner, 0.55, 0.8, and you can see how these measurements have been taken primarily from microscopy, and as such, these data are best reflected by this mass fractal dimension. And if we actually do the simulation, and what we see here We see this at the beginning plateau. We don't really follow in this inception area where the particles are liquid-like. But then later on, actually, this goes straight through the error bars of the data. And at the same time here, for completeness, I calculate how the mass mobility exponent changes. And you can see here that this actually has a quite different variation. Same trend, it will go down the mass mobility, but quantitatively different values. This type of work now brings us to the next level of simulations. And here, actually, I need to point out that there is a whole a poster by George Kelesidis, who will actually be happy to share with you the details of this model development. And with this, I want to go to give you a flavor of the next level, the molecular dynamics. Professor Vaioli has been doing some beautiful molecular dynamics, and yesterday I saw her presentation. But now I want to show you what is the emphasis here on this field. And again, here we have the fusion of two particles. These are two rutile particles, and here these are a slice of the particles in the middle, and I have artificially colored the bulk part of the particles green for the titanium atom, and red for the oxygen, and blue and yellow for the titanium, yellow for the outside, and blue the oxygen. And what I will show you a movie now, what we try to learn from these simulations. And the interesting part here is we want to find out what happens to these surface atoms here. Why? Because typically we are using values for sintering from the ceramics literature. But in ceramics literature, the particles are typically packed. They don't have the free surfaces that we have typically in flames, in the aerosols. And this, as we know, on the nanoscale, this outer film is actually quite mobile. If you look at the microscope, it's actually very lively. And that's what we wanted to see. What difference does it make? So again, this will be a movie now. And I want you to pay attention how this part of the particle will be filled. You see, if we have a grain boundary diffusion or we have a surface diffusion. And also another thing you will see, as the particles actually they are moving, at some point they are locking, forming the so-called this lattice. And this is a characteristic of these sintered particles. Same thing we have with soot formation, this so-called graphitic layers. And that's actually how it forms. And this is what, but again, I cannot stop the film. So please take a look at it. So here we are. At this point now, you see, it locked. At this point now, this is very important when you make semiconducting particles, because this is actually how you facilitate the transport of electrons. This is quite important. And later on, of course, if we allow the movie, you will see here that everything, that mostly this will be filled up by blue and yellow. Typically, we have a surface diffusion. It is the surface, actually, atoms that they diffuse, and this is how they drive the sintering here, rather than the classic grain boundary that it was known in this field. So what we do with this data, let me now go back. We actually plot here the characteristic sintering time as a function of the particle diameter. And you can see here how, of course, as the particles become bigger, they need longer time to fuse. And this is the definition of the sintering time. And if you compare this with what is in the literature, you see that actually at about this 3 or 4 or 5 actually nanometers, you start converging to these bulk values. And this is for a given temperature of 1800 degrees. And if we actually go to 19 or 2000, the same picture. And this is very reminiscent of the classic paper of gold sintering. What you see here, this is the sintering temperature, the melting point of gold as a function of the particle diameter in angstroms. And you can see here that actually at about 50 angstroms or 5 nanometers, you see this transition from the bulk values to the nano, to this rapid. So sintering again, coalescence, follows what you know from the melting point. Having said this, now we are coming to the, excuse me, how we are using this, essentially, graphs like that. This is going back to correct the sintering rates and essentially introduce those in the mesoscale models that you saw before, and eventually in the continuum for the CFD, and essentially this is molecular dynamics driven estimation of parameters for the process design. Today, now the focus is, for example, how crystallinity. This is what is really important, is these early stages of particle formation, how the crystal characteristics. In this case, we have the fusion of a crystalline particle with an amorphous. And you can see here a small amorphous, of course, as the collisions take place, eventually forms these twin structures. And this is consistent with what people have seen in experimental observations. And of course, if you all do the opposite, again, a crystalline particle with a big amorphous in the beginning, the crystalline particle is losing its crystalline state, but eventually, give it enough time, we have recrystallization. If you are actually at these conditions, you start forming again the domains. So this is what we talked before. If you have long enough residence time, you will be able to develop the crystalline particles. Otherwise, in the short ones, this becomes a challenge. Now, this quantitative understanding facilitates scale-up. You can see now our efforts in our laboratories early on in Zurich, where we had built these backhouse filters and flames now on this producing 700 grams per hour of silica. And also, I will show you here the actual assistant who is doing the work, Mr. René Plus, originally from Suisse. And really, these are quite big. You need to develop the area to collect these particles and properly operate. But most important here, this today we operate much differently what we did before, as you saw on my first slide. You can see now our students with proper protection here. Laboratories in synthesis, material synthesis, operate typically at about 38 millibars below atmospheric to assure that your neighbors are not excited if you open the door and your particles go out. So essentially, you try to have this kind of protection in your own university. And even you can have your colleague, you see here Dr. Wegner, even handling the powders. I insist, the powders we are handling, it's unknown. As such, we have to treat them. We don't know what kind of properties they have. Can be beneficial, can be also non-attractive. So you have to wear this, but you cannot keep your colleagues under pressure all the time. You need to give them a little relief. So with this, we can keep moving and actually drive innovation. And what I want to point out is what Christoph Schulz mentioned earlier. This is a development in our labs, this flames pyrolysis with Professor Mandler, now in Bremen. And what is this is actually, at that time I was interacting, he pointed out, I was looking for applications. And one of the people that I interact a lot is Professor Biker. He's a giant in catalysis. And people in catalysis, they have a tremendous appetite of using every single element of the periodic table. So it's not so easy with a classic vapor-fed flames to do that. So you have to be creative. And this actually, at that time, I happened to have Lutz Mandler in the group who were able to put that together and came just quite handy. And you can see here, these are actually a spray flame producing platinum on alumina. And you see this Mickey Mouse-looking particle with the ears, which are, you know, the platinum and the alumina support. And actually, in this field, you can be quite creative, and I want to point out what Christoph pointed to me, that recently he, with the help of Lutz and Andreas Kempf, they won a major grant from the German National Science Foundation for 30 PhD students to study flame spray pyrolysis for 6 years. We are talking about a 6 million grant, and I hope he brings some of the students in the next meeting in Dublin to tell us what they discover. And the interesting part now is having, you know, this capacity to make any particle you want, you can actually do other creative things. What is the fascinating picture here is that actually you can control from the atomic to the nanoscale the mixing of your components. So if you have a flame now, this is the goal is to produce this catalyst with the alumina support. And this is very important for pollution. This is the so-called nitrogen oxide storage reduction catalyst, where you can actually take NO and eventually produce pure nitrogen by storing in the form of barium nitrate here. But this particular catalyst is not easy to make. If you make it in one flame, it forms aluminate, which is not so efficient. However, if you make it in these twin ones, this is the flame that contains the alumina, and this is the barium, and actually you can salt and pepper the platinum on top of it, as you saw on the previous slide. And you can see here, this is an ugly looking picture because the barium is not well distributed on the particles, while this good looking, very uniform distribution is not really good, is not really an effective catalyst. And of course, you can see this, I won't get to the details. This one has the beautiful structure of the barium carbonate, while the next one, while the bottom, the black, which is this one, has the pure alumina. And of course, the moment of truth here is how much nitrogen oxide you actually pick up. You see, makes a big difference, that type of mixing between the single flame and the twin flames here. Having said this, today, this technology, actually, I was yesterday night talking to people in Johnson Matthey again. They have installed it in outside of London, in Reading. And this also has motivated to make particles, not only this Mickey Mouse looking with an individual platinum on top of it, but also hermetically coated. Many times you want to get, you know, the performance of the particle, the magnetic, the coloristic, but this surface is highly undesirable. So in that case, you need to put a layer on top of it. And what you see here, you see this crystalline titania and this beautiful nano-thin silica layer, and you can see on top of that. How do you do this? Exactly by what we described before, this multi-scale process design, where actually you can take particles coming out of the flame by decoupling the formation with the coating. You can put at a low temperature this glass layer on top of this, and this has motivated actually the building of a center in Harvard, where actually people are looking into the difference between the chemical and the physical toxicity of the particles. What I mean with physical can be on the nano, on the size, and you can have like this neutral coated particles, and on top of it and below it can be silver, a toxic material, and you can see the difference that you have with or without this layer, and I can actually learn a lot by the fundamentals of this of the toxicity on these particles. And you can see here actually how we test this by looking into the how you control the process parameters of the flame here and the so-called photocatalytic performance. And you like to see that eventually, by controlling the fluid mechanics here, you can fully coat the particles in that fashion. Having said this, time to do what all of this means. At this point now, I'm really happy to tell you that we have brand new flame-made products. If you go to a nano conference, people say that the new product, the biggest product of nanotechnology today, is nano-silver. Of course, they forget carbon black, they forget fumed silica, correct? Conveniently, because in that field, people believe that nano was discovered 30 years ago. That's not true. Nevertheless, nano-silver 10 years ago was in big trouble. Why? Because there was actually discussion that nano-silver, because it was killing the aquatic biolife, is actually to be, if EPA had been petitioned, to label nano-silver as pesticide. And you know, if you label such a material in that form, you can no longer bring it in the lab, not even talk about selling it and so on. So we're able actually to help on that by making, in this case, as you can see here, immobilizing the silver onto silica particles and making them from different sizes. And we're able to decouple the interaction between silver ions, which are the toxic component, than the silver particles themselves. And today, of course, and you see this little logo here of a spin-off which makes it in the flame. Now, this is the slide of my opening presentation. This is a carbon-coated cobalt, and this sells for $105 for 500 milligrams of dry powder. You can do the algebra. This means 200,000 for a kilo, okay? And this is actually some of the opportunities. Of course, when the company makes this for a kilo, they charge you less than that. It's about 50,000, still more than gold, but nevertheless, it's an opportunity that I think people should be aware of what is coming up. Another spin-off now from Netha Zurich is actually this, what they make, the so-called flame-to-order nanoparticle composition. If you go to the website, like on this one, you see the periodic table and you choose which element you want in your particles, what composition, and then you have to expect from them what will cost you 1 gram of it, 10 grams, whatever you're willing to pay for it. So this is, and all of this is done by this spray combustion that I just mentioned. So besides now the products in the market already, what is coming up? What is new? Really new now is this, what we call single atom catalysts. Everybody knows that heavy nanoparticles are very good to make, but now recently has been shown that if you actually strip the metallic clusters from the ceramic support, they found a very good performance of the remaining metallic noble metals on top of the support. So what is actually the importance, the interaction between the metal and the support. So the ideal, the dream would have been to have this. But however, this is not easy to do by wet chemistry, because typically you have to precipitate and then go through an elaborate etching involving cyanides and so on. But what you know in this field, you can actually provide in a very low concentration of the noble metal, it will make this salt and pepper. It won't be as big as the Mickey Mouse ears that you saw earlier. They will be small, but they will get the job done. Another application, now, of course, Kakeru Fujiwara, who's on the front line, will tell you more if you go to his poster on Friday. It is just before the reception, and this glorious reception of the Combustion Institute, so I think it's worth taking a look at it. You can make phosphors for tumor imaging and authentication. Another idea is actually you can make conductive composites by embedding these nanoparticles, metallic nanoparticles, into the polymer, and actually you can see here this layer, and you can light up this LED. You can actually make particles which are good for you, good to eat. This is a picture of chocolate yogurt. However, if you want to fortify the food, typically the standard of the field is to put iron sulfate. Iron sulfate will give a metallic flavor. Yogurt won't taste the same. However, if you make particles in the flame, in this case, iron phosphate, look at the beauty. You can hardly distinguish between the original. And why? Because when the particles are very small, they are actually quite transparent. And also, if they are very small, when you take them in the stomach, very quickly dissolve on this 3 to 4 pH. So this is enough to bring the iron in the ionic form, and this has created now a whole interest. So when you go now to the supermarket to get these multivitamins, people are dreaming now making multi-mineral by putting those in this kind of zinc, iron, and you name it, in this medications. I just talked about it. This is this silica-coated iron. This is Janus particles. This is the magnetic component. This is the silver, the coloristic, at the same time has the metallic. And this actually can give you the impact if you want to do a thermal treatment of a tumor. Dental fillers for bone replacement. And I'm coming now to the devices, because this is where actually in our laboratory we are very excited, where actually you can make now devices using combustion. And this is the key part here, and this is an electronic nose as I have here. So what is the story here? Again, if we go, this is the classic way how to make a film. You start with a precursor, you put in a liquid solution, you will make the powder, then the powder dispense in a solution, or you make a paste, and then either by spray deposition, doctor blading, you will make it on a support, and then you have to carefully dry it, because if you don't dry it carefully, you will create these cracks, and this is not very attractive in this business. And then, if you make it on the flame in one step, then you will see that these particles actually, you can make them quite uniform, because you do not involve the drying, taking out the water of these supports. And of course, however, if you look closely, because it involves particle deposition, these are very fluffy, beautiful structures. Beautiful is the word, but can you use it? Not really. Because if you actually go, because typically in this field, you want actually to go and cut and grind, you know, the sensors to make several of them, everything goes, so we have this annealing, the in situ annealing, and essentially you get from these fluffy structures to these cauliflower structures, and eventually you will make these sensors, which is the beauty, because by 2,000 degrees you're depositing particles on an electronic circuit that otherwise it would have melted out just by seeing the flame. However, by rapidly cooling, and to make the long story short, I have to march through the slides, we discovered in the flames you can make this unique phase of tungsten oxide. Tungsten oxide is a very beautiful material. I was just talking to Nikolai Barzan in Tübingen, and he told me after our studies here with this, he looked very closely into that and he found out that he's high resistance to water. And this is very important to avoid humidity effects. And what is the interesting part is what you see here is the sensitivity to acetone for different gases, ethanol, methanol, and you name it. Having, you know, a sensor that is sensitive to ethanol, this actually gives the opportunity to make a contribution to the diabetes. Because people who suffer from diabetes, they have to prick their finger 3 times a day, and from that, actually, to decide the meal. The dream here is if you have something that can detect the so-called the diabetes breath, the sweet breath, which is the acetone, this actually you can bypass that. And this is what we have been able to develop. And you can see here now that you can detect acetone down to 20 parts per billion. And remember, a healthy person, the acetone level is 1 part per million. A diabetic has 2 parts per billion. Sorry, 2 parts per million, it's 1 and 2 per million. So to have, you know, some sensors, you need to be accurate on this 10 parts per billion. And this is the achievement here. Having said this, of course, it's one way to have this beautiful sensor, but you have to miniaturize it. And this is what we have been developing with our colleagues in ETH in the micro-machining, and we have been able to miniaturize. And that's what you see, the picture here. And of course, if you go to my lab next to the gym now that you saw, we have a bike. And even myself, I have to bike, and they measure my breath because I'm an old person. All the students are young, they will tell you here. So that way you can check, you know, the older, the younger people, how they respond to this effects. And what is the beauty, this slide, what it shows the moment of truth here, because the blue line is the acetone, our sensor. This gray line is the mass spectrometer, because truly speaking, the sensor does not know if it's acetone, methanol, you name it. You need to benchmark, to verify. And this is what you see here. And during cycling, you emit isoprene, and this isoprene actually, does it interfere with the breath? And that's what we have here to deal with. Having said this, now you can see the pictures. I want the pictures to speak by themselves for offline and online. And here, what we found out, that these sensors actually pick up the diabetic in the early morning, before eating, which is the standard measurement for diagnosis that the American Diabetics Association, the American the Medical Association, actually recommends for the decision if the person is diabetic or not. And this has motivated now the building up of an industrial prototype for clinical evaluation, and now in Zurich we are in the process of setting up these clinical studies, much more people than what you saw on these earlier studies, because now if you want to look at broadly, you need to have this clinical data. And the final part of my presentation is, and I was lucky to have this acetone, I have this kind of special material, this epsilon tungsten oxide. What happens if I want to go to something else? In that case now, again, combustion can make particles of different sizes, different composition, and this we're tackling now the cancer issue, because here we're looking for the screening of people, and you cannot do MRI to everybody, it's very expensive. The idea is, can you do some breath screening to people and then decide if they need to go for an MRI? I won't tell you much because I see there is some motion on the first lines here. The focus here is now is building up these sensors, and you can see now this sensor, you can see here is the size of the thumb, how it looks like. And to make the long story short, this actually is quite promising, and we are able actually to detect now formaldehyde with different sensors, and you can see here it's rather disappointing because you can see every sensor, the formaldehyde is not even the most sensitive part. It's actually overwhelmed by the other gases. But in this case, what you can do, you have to rely on mathematics. And this year, by setting up the so-called multivariate screening, you can actually look into the variability, and eventually, if I go straight to the final slide, this is what we have, the estimated formaldehyde from the actual, and you see they are fall on the line here, and if I put, these are, if I have three members in the mixture, or if I have 4, they have the agreement is holds in all of those. With this now, I want to close my presentation with 4 points. First of all, I hope I convince you that combustion enables material synthesis at the tons per hour level. Coagulation, sintering, and surface growth control, primary aggregate particle size, structure, and composition, and through this primarily the high temperature residence time, an array of high-value materials are produced, mostly by spray combustion, creating new products and applications. And the last point I want to make, this drive renewed interest on the fundamentals. The question is how combustion variables affect particle characteristics, and they, in turn, how they affect product performance. If you can make that connection, this is what actually creates opportunities for the field, creates products in the market, and jobs actually for our students and the people in the broader field. With this, I would like to thank you all for your patience to listen to me, and this is the group of people who have actually helped me to do all of those. And with this, I'll be happy to answer any questions, if there is the time, because I'm not sure the chairman here, how he feels about it. Thank you.
One feels guilty about interrupting such a very interesting talk a little bit early in the piece, but unfortunately we had to do that. You'll agree with me, it's a very, very interesting and certainly a different view of combustion, which is viewed as heat sources and power generation. This is a different flame-made products, and what's more, flame-made products that could make you rich. So this is quite a... an exciting talk that I'm sure will trigger new direction in the minds of some young people thinking about new directions in combustion research. Unfortunately, we are... shall we take one question?
As many as you can. I love answering questions.
It's tempting. So let's just take one question from the audience, if there is that burning question.
Hi, thanks for the very good talk. I'm Joaquin Camacho from San Diego State. I'm wondering whether there's any work on looking at the gas beyond the metal precursor itself, or any effects of oxygen or other surrounding environments that can also be implemented into these synthesis strategies.
Absolutely. Everything counts. The precursor, the environment. I have another slide by progressively changing the oxidant composition from air to actual pure oxygen, you can see you go from aggregated structures to perfect spheres. Whatever you can change, this high temperature residence time can have an impact on the characteristics of the particles. I will be happy to show you the pictures. I had to take them out of the presentation. I ran into trouble without even showing those.
No, but I believe you, I believe you.
I think Pop had something. Yes, she wanted.
Okay, well, one, this is definitely the last one.
Oh, no, she brings it.
Yes.
Thank you so much for that wonderful talk, and thank you for the plug. I wanted, just one comment is, just to clear up, I hope I didn't miscommunicate that agglomerates are loosely bound, van der Waals, held together by van der Waals forces, and aggregates are covalently bound. So it's like, I didn't understand exactly what you're saying, but I agree with you completely on the terminology. I think it's important to get it right. But the question I had was more related to one of the issues that we have in like third world countries in particular is emissions of particulates that have a lot of embedded chlorine in them. And I was intrigued by your flame measurements with titanium chloride, and how the particles change significantly in how you have the mixing of the fuel with the doped species. And I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit about the composition of those particles and how that changes, and whether or not you think there may be a way that we could, just in the way we do incineration in some of these recycling plants, change the composition of particles that escape from the I know that's a kind of a broad question.
What I can quickly say here is that actually doping, because if your question was if doping affects the characteristics of the particle, I have to be honest with you, in pigments, and for example, it is the control of particle size is not done by the temperature, what I just described, but by doping. It's the most effective way to control the characteristics. Even, you know, on these sensors that we made to detect the acetone, we lock the beautiful phase. This epsilon tungsten oxide by doping originally was with chromium, but you couldn't go with chromium to the doctors, so we had actually to replace it with silicon. And now, so doping is a key part and changes the characteristics of the particles dramatically. I'll be happy to discuss with you more in this conference later on.
Very good. I'll bring it to an end. So please join with me in thanking Professor Pasini.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you, Christoph, also for organizing all of that.
Right. Thank you very much. Thank you.